Alright, so, The Incompatibility of Free Will and Determinism is a paper by Peter van Inwagen, who is the philosopher who is known to have reduced the knowledge of God. And it's a really nice paper. It's kind of very difficult to read when you read it for the first time, because it feels like he's just throwing all this terminology at you and you kind of don't really know why. So you gotta just bear with me for like the first half of the paper, which we're going to discuss. It's going to all make sense, and that's the beautiful part about it, when we come to what van Inwagen calls the main argument, because everything from the very beginning builds up to that point, so that once you go through the main argument, you realize, damn, all right, everything is coming together now, and that's the really exciting part. So, first, we have a bunch of technical hoo-ha, the definition of determinism, a definition of free will, and some remarks about Kant. I will try to go through those as smoothly, as swiftly, but also as completely as possible. And then we have the juicy bit, which is the main argument, and kind of also the defense of the main argument. So, first of all, I would like to pose some questions to you. You can like roll them around in your head during the presentation. We are going to talk about them after the presentation. So, did van Inwagen's main argument change your opinion on the compatibility or contents of free will and determinism? If so, how? If not, why? What are your thoughts on his defense of the main argument? Do you buy the premises, i.e. the definition of Kant and determinism? To what degree do former events influence our present lives? And do you think we can be held responsible for what we do? Just pick one or two of those, keep them in your head, try to answer them during my presentation, and then we will go back to them at the very end. So, let's start. The dry but really, really important stuff. I already said that, definition of determinism, definition of free will, and remarks about Kant. I will have in the top right corner a hoo-ha count. Hoo-has are, for me, things that he says which do not immediately seem relevant, right? Of course, you realize they are contextually relevant, but it's more like, okay, you're throwing a really big amount of stuff at me here, and I'm not quite sure how to apply it yet. So I will count the hoo-has, and when we get to the main argument, we will count the hoo-has down to determine whether all of the hoo-has were actually necessary. Okay, so the definition of determinism. First of all, we will have a look at what state of the worlds are, or rather what van Inwagen means when he talks about states of the world. So, a state of the world is a proposition, which in this situation means a set of conditions that describes everything about the world at one instance of time, which we call T. So if there's any change in the world, any minute state, we have entered into a new state of the world. And obviously, we can have multiple instances of time, and thus multiple states of the world, denoting everything that is true about the world at that certain time. But a state of the world cannot contain a property, so a constituent like, in 10 minutes, a sack of rice in China is going to fall over. So it can describe everything that's happening right now, but nothing about the future. That's very important. So, to illustrate this a little bit further, I have prepared two states of the world, state W1 and W2. State W2 is at a time later than state W1. Can anybody point out to me the difference between those two states? No, right? Well, there is a difference, definitely, and we're gonna look at it right now. So if we zoom in on this lovely little section where we have a bunch of people sitting around a table waiting to get served this gross-looking red soup where the wizard's beard is hanging into it, we see that that's what's happening right now in state W1, but then all of a sudden something magical happens. In the next instance of time, bam! Using the power of his massively enlarged prefrontal cortex, Peter van Inwagen just appears out of nothing. And, well, sadly, that small little guy next to the wizard, he is out of existence now. But a change in the state of the world has happened when Peter van Inwagen manifested among those zany cartoon characters. So, if we go back to this slide here again, Now maybe you can try to find Van Inwagen. He's somewhere. Yeah, it's hard to point at it right now because of physical limitations with video recording. But point being, you know now there has been a change in the state of the world, and I admit that the physical manifestation of a grown man amidst cartoon characters is not really a minute change in the state of the world, but just imagine like any small little wither in a blade of grass or some tiny chemical process happening right now in a leaf on a tree or something. Every observable change in the state of the world marks a new state of the world. Oh, and also there's Waldo. So this begs the question, how did Van Inwagen manifest amidst all those zany characters? Or rather, how do we get from one state of the world to another? How do these changes occur? How do they make sense? And the answer is the laws of physics. So that's hoo-ha number two. Van Inwagen defines the laws of physics as a set of contingent and true propositions. He says that there is no such set that he knows of, but the definition that he gives is sort of vague enough that you can actually get a pretty good idea of what he's talking about. So a set of true and contingent propositions means that they are supposed to be propositions that are true under certain conditions. Right? They don't have to be true under all conditions, but under certain conditions they need to always be true when these conditions apply. They must not entail the existence of some concrete individual, so saying that I'm able to, I don't know, lift this remote, that's not a physical law. But a physical law would be, we have this thing which has a certain mass, which therefore has a certain weight, and if we exert X amount of physical strength in a upward manner, we should be able to lift it. So that puts me out of the picture, and it reduces the content of what we're talking about to physical laws. Like, that's not one physical law, but it's a bunch of physical laws happening at once to explain the situation. We also need clear propositions, so really not what I just did, and also not something like a nuclear bomb exerts a lot of energy, but rather the real specifics. Also, if we, for example, look at the law that nothing can travel faster than light, that is quite specific. If we now figure out that somebody, call her Sarah, she figured out how to accelerate particles faster than the speed of light. That now only means that the previous law that we had established is not correct anymore. Or rather, we have to extend that law to include the conditions under which we can accelerate a particle to a speed that is faster than light. So it's really not about our definition of a law of physics, but rather about what is really universally true. So also there, Van Inwagen excludes psychological laws about voluntary behavior of rational agents, because he thinks, and I think there is some truth to that, that these are not set in stone enough to be regarded as consistent enough. But laws of physics also include, of course, but only to make sure, laws from other fields like biology and chemistry. So we're not simply talking about the scientific domain that we call physics, but about everything that is ultimately true about the universe or constituents of it and governs their inner workings. That's what we call laws of physics in this content. All right, so let's move on to our third hoo-ha, the definition of determinism. Now for real, we have determined what states of the world are. We have determined what laws of physics are. And now Peter Van Inwagen says that in determinism, from the conjunction of any state of the world and the laws of physics, follows any later state of the world. And now I realize I have messed up a little bit. Because I would have had a blackboard in the real presentation, but I do not have that right now. So we need to talk about logical connectors right now. So truth functional logic. truth functional logic is a way to determine the validity of arguments in a sort of arithmetic mathematical way, to put it like really, really roughly. So we have the conjunction. A conjunction, come on. A conjunction looks like this. We have a proposition, so just imagine that this is a statement, like, I don't know, I'm human. We have another statement, and we have the conjunction symbol. So, the conjunction of A and B is only true if A and B are both true. So, if A is false, the conjunction is false. If B is false, the conjunction is false. And if A and B are false, then, well, that's also false. Then we have, and I will write this a bit bigger because it makes sense, the conditional, also known as entailment. So a conditional looks like this. A entails B is what this says. So this is a tiny bit more complicated, but in essence, if A is a true statement, then if B follows from A, B must be true. If B is true, if B is false, A cannot be true. Now, if A is false, B can be whatever it wants, and this entailment is still accurate. So, if a state of the world is true, so we have all the propositions of a singular state, and they are all hitting the mark, they are all correct, and the laws of physics are true, so we have determined what they are, and they are, no, we don't really need to determine them, but they exist and they are correct. Then the state of the world following from the conjunction of those must also be true. So just imagine that A here is this conjunction of a state of the world and the laws of physics. Then from that follows B, another state of the world in this case. So we have a conjunction here. Remember, this is what a conjunction looks like, A and B. If one of those is false, the first constituent here, the A, would be false. So in order for this to be... Wait, no. In order for this to be true, this must also be true. If this is false, then we run into a problem. We're going to talk about that in more detail later. So that's our third hoo-ha. And now, yeah, well, everybody's still with me here, I don't know, maybe some people have already turned off, I hope I will remember that I put this there in the presentation, otherwise it will just scare me as well. Alright, so now to our fourth hoo-ha, the definition of free will. We have determined what determinism is now, so that's great, but we want to know if determinism and free will are compatible. So, free will is defined as the power or ability of agents to act otherwise than they in fact do. So, for example, there's this example in the text of Smith who sees a drowning child and he decides not to help that child. So now we wonder, would Smith have actually been able to help the child? Like, would he have been able to make that decision? And if we say that Smith has free will, yes, he should have been able to make that decision and to just go and save the child. We will see why that's problematic in terms of determinism later. Without free will, some argue that you cannot be held accountable for your actions, which is why this debate is direly relevant to the justice system, and why it also... Like, there has been a case where a really, really good lawyer actually argued for their clients in terms of that they weren't able to act otherwise because of determinism, and they actually got through. And, well, so that's a good reason to think about this stuff. But talking about the word can, and that's a problem, is quite difficult in a philosophical context. So we will use an idiom. An idiom is basically a way to... I forgot what an idiom is. I will have to look that up. Remember that. So, can as an idiom basically means that we redefine, we specify what the word can means. So, we define can as an agent, S being the name of the agent, can render or could have rendered proposition P false. So as an example, he could have reached Chicago by midnight would turn, if we applied the idiom, into he could have reached the proposition that he did not reach Chicago by midnight false. I forgot a parenthesis there. So yeah, he did not reach Chicago, but it would have been possible for him to render the proposition that he did not reach Chicago false by actually being in Chicago by midnight. So yeah, it's not really obvious why this is necessary. In normal day ascription of agency, it's really not. But when we get down to cases like we do in this paper, it's kind of helpful. And Van Inwagen makes that clear by showing a kind of complicated example. Oh, well, it's not really that complicated, but the way he expresses this is bonkers complicated. And it took me a hell of a lot of time to wrap my head around that. So, I've broken it down to be way less confusing. We have the claim that Aristotle could have rendered Plato's last true proposition false, and that is either true or false. Now, to determine the truth value of this statement, we need to determine, for one, the conditions under which Plato's last true proposition would have been false, and whether Aristotle would have actually been able to produce those conditions, because otherwise we can't really say that he could have proven the that he could have rendered Plato's last true proposition false. So, we have two examples for possible propositions that Plato could have asserted on his deathbed, for example. The first one would be, Aristotle cannot live in Athens from the point of my death till the point of his death. So, the condition to falsify this statement would be that Aristotle would have needed to, or he would need to live in Athens from the time of Plato's death till his own death. Which is something that he can do. He just needs to move to Athens, pack his stuff, go there, and maybe don't drink that poison stuff that actually killed you in the end. Never mind. Then we have another proposition, which would be that the planets do not move in perfect circles. The condition to falsify that would be some sort of proof that they don't, right? But as it turns out, like what we know today with our scientific equipment, we determined that they do not move in perfect circles. And Aristotle could not have produced these conditions because A, he did not have the necessary equipment, and B, even if he had the equipment, the planets do not move in perfect circles. So there was no way for him to falsify this particular proposition. So basically, all this means is that this is a way in which we can use this idiom to actually be useful. And oh my god, I'm so tired. To actually be useful and make ascriptions about what someone is able to do and is not able to do. So what the hell, Peter, do we need all this for? The main argument. Now when we look at the main argument, there isn't really a lot that Peter immediately, that Van Inwagen immediately says about why he assigned all this previously. But I will do it because it makes this whole thing feel a lot more rewarding. So the main argument is a logical argument against the compatibility of free will and determinism. Its aim is to provide a logical proof that free will and determinism are incompatible, which is supposed to be a general proof, so it's not supposed to be reliant on any of the characters that we are going to get to know in the scenario that we're going to play through. It's not dependent on that scenario. It is applicable to different scenarios all around the spectrum of what people are able to do and not to do. It runs under certain conditions, one of which being that there are no external criteria influencing the storyline that unfolds, and all the characters are of normative mental and physical condition. And at last it involves a bunch of components, which would be like a list of variables, I suppose. J represents a judge. T and T0 represent two instances of time. T0 being an instance of time before the birth of J, and T being the instance of time that we are talking about in the scenario, which I'm going to explain shortly. P denotes the proposition describing the state of the world at time T, which I will shorten to P is the state of the world at time T. Those don't mean the same, but it's way easier to say it this way. Correspondingly, P0 is a state of the world at time T0. L is the laws of physics, or denotes the laws of physics, rather. And now we're ready to go. I will keep these definitions up on the right-hand corner of the screen. So in case you forget any of them, you can just have a look at them. And also, if there's any unclarity along the way of this argument, please just interrupt me and ask me. I will explain it to death until you get it. It's okay. But if you don't ask, I can't help you. So, the main argument, the scenario. A judge J needs to raise his hand to prevent the execution of an accused at time T. That's like the signal they have agreed on in their country. This is how you show that, as a judge, you grant special clarity to a certain individual to not be executed. J refrains from raising his hand. That would be at time T. So, a necessary condition for P, the proposition that describes the state of the world at time T, to be true, would be that J's hand is not raised. Also, J has sufficient time to deliberate and was not manipulated or intoxicated in any way. Or, in other words, no external criteria, normative, mental, and physical condition. Now, the main argument, I think I just skipped a slide there, yeah. The main argument consists of me having a sip of water because I'm dying. It consists of six premises and a conclusion. The conclusion following these six premises. So, we will have a look at all of these premises in detail to give Van Inwagen a chance to defend all of them and to explain them all in detail. The first premise. If determinism is true, then the conjunction of P0 and L entails P. We talked about this previously, and this is also our first hoo-ha. The definition of determinism has just now become relevant. Also, which will something that will be relevant throughout this entire argument, which he doesn't really talk about, is formal logic, so that's just something that I squeezed in there that should be quite helpful. So yeah, I think this is fairly obvious, right? If you got the definition of determinism right, then one state of the world conjuncted with the laws of physics entails another state of the world. So this present state of the world is entailed by a state before my birth, for example, and the laws of physics. And in this case, we're talking about a state before the birth of the judge and the laws of physics, which led him to this situation that he's now in. So it follows logically from the definition of determinism. Clear so far? All right, very good. So, second premise. If J had raised his hand at T, P would be false. Another hoo-ha, the states of the world. We're now using these again. The state of the world in this case contains the constituent that J's hand is not raised. My alarm clock's going off. The J's hand is not raised. So, if J is to raise his hand, then P would be false, right? Because I put it there in terms of logic. From P follows the conjunction of all conditions that are true about the state of the world at time T and J's hand not being raised. So if we just isolate that from the other components that make up the state of the world, that's how we would do it. Any questions about this? All right, let's go to the next one. 3. If 2 is true, then J could have rendered P false if he could have raised his hand at T. We have two hoo-has here, the remarks about can and the definition of free will. So this is where this stuff about Aristotle comes in handy, because SJ is not physically or mentally unable to raise his hand. He would have objectively, if we would ascribe free will to him, that's where that comes in, been able to produce the conditions necessary to falsify the state of the world, P. So, J could have rendered the proposition that he did not raise his hand false as a true statement from our idiom. Any questions about that? You can't answer me, so that's just great. 4. If J could have rendered P false and P0 and L entails, like the conjunction of P0 and L, entails P, then he could have rendered P0 and L false. This is like basic maths now, right? In order to be able to render P false, we need to be able to render the conjunction of P0 and L false because P is entailed by said conjunction. If we now remember that when the entailed component of our conjunction, no, it's not a conjunction, of our entailment is false, then the antecedent, the precedent, oh, Jesus Christ, the first component cannot be false. So if J is able to raise his hand and therefore render P false, he needs to be able to do something about this conjunction of P0 and L. That's very important. Now, in the fifth premise, it says that if J could have rendered the conjunction of P0 and L false, he could have rendered L false. This makes quite a bit of sense because P0 is something he can definitely not do anything about because it happened at a time where he wasn't even born. And it's fairly obvious that we could say that there's nothing he could really do about that. Van Inwagen illustrates this with the following argument, which is also a conjunction, and he says that he could render it false. And this conjunction contains, as the first premise, the Spanish Armada was defeated in 1588, and as a second one, Peter Van Inwagen never visits Alaska. So, this conjunction would be false if Peter Van Inwagen was to visit Alaska, and that is obviously something that he's able to do, him being a professor at a university and probably like having at least a reasonable amount of money that he would be able to visit Alaska if it was his sole goal to prove this premise wrong. But he couldn't do anything about the defeat of the Spanish Armada in 1588 because he was born in, I think, 1942, and he doesn't have a time machine. So, leading us to our sixth premise, and also our fifth hoo-ha. So we got all the hoo-has out of the way, they were all necessary, and that's really great and all. So we are going to talk about the laws of physics, because J could not have rendered L false, is the sixth premise. And, well, that also makes a lot of sense, because who is J? A god? He can't render the laws of physics false. We have determined that the laws of physics are what is ultimately true about the inner workings of the universe. So there's nothing he can do about it, and if he could prove any of the laws that we have written down as with our tiny little monkey brains, then he would have just extended the laws of the universe, so whatever. Alright, and from all that, Van Inwagen concludes that if determinism is true, J could not have raised his hand at T. This basically means that, like, the second part, that J could have not raised his hand at T, that's basically a replacement for free will. If determinism is true, free will is false. And this goes vice versa if you swap it out in the argument. If free will is true, then determinism is false. So Van Inwagen doesn't make a statement about us not having free will or determinism being false. He's just saying that if one of them is true, the other one is necessarily false. Alright, which now brings us... I think I skipped a slide again? No. Which now brings us to the defense of the main argument. This is where he kind of throws shade on his colleagues. He doesn't really name anyone, I think. But it constantly feels like he has someone certain in mind who he's talking to. so yeah, there's like three main critiques that he addresses. The first of which being the criteria argument. The criteria argument, as I think all the other critiques of the argument as well, They don't find a flaw in the argument, but they still hold that free will and determinism are compatible. The proponents of the criteria argument argue that there are certain criteria to determine the meaning of a sentence like could have acted otherwise. But since these criteria do not mention determinism, they say that something like could have acted otherwise, so our definition of free will, doesn't really, it doesn't touch with determinism. They do not collide, they don't have anything to do with each other, and they say that the complexity of the main argument simply serves to hide an error, like the infamous argument that 0 equals 1, where it's, there is some error in there, like hidden away in under like 56 layers of maths, and you can extrapolate that and learn something from that, but they say it's just craziness. So, in defense to that, Benenbeggen says, no, 0 equals 0, I'm putting my foot down here. He says that the most useful thing to do against this main argument would be to find an actual flaw in the argument, which the proponents of the criteria argument don't do. He also says that the criteria argument is simply invalid, and as an example for that, he uses the notion of predestinarianism, which I think is a notion that he more or less made up, but more or less also exists. Not quite sure. Anyways, predestinarianism holds that if an act is foreseen, it is not free, and also that every act is foreseen by God. So, following from this definition, there is no free act, right? But since predestinarianism is no criterion for could have done otherwise, or in other words, for free will, those should be compatible, right? Because they don't touch if we use this idea of compatible, of the criteria argument. But obviously, if you look at these two premises for predestinarianism, you can't have predestinarianism and free will. It simply doesn't work. And he also says that the complexity of the main argument simply serves to draw out conceptual connections between free will and determinism, which he could not have done otherwise. So, yeah, that's what that's for, I guess. Now, there's another angle from which some people come, which would be the idea that free will entails determinism. Those people say that to say that someone acted freely is at least to say that they acted, and if, for example, somebody raised their arm, but it then turns out that there was actually no cause for them raising their arm, we wouldn't really say that they raised their arm, right? We would say it was an involuntary muscle twitch or whatever. But we only say that they raised their arm when it was caused by their character, their desires, or their beliefs. And so, yeah, I can't nicht mehr. And I guess that's why people say that free will entails determinism. But again, Van Inwagen strikes back and says, no, you fools are all wrong. What you're doing here is an ignoratio elenchi, so an argument that proves the wrong point. He says that he never claimed that free will was incompatible with the idea that every event has a cause, and that this is all that the idea of free will entails determinism actually proves. So let's move on to the conditional analysis, which is a notion again concerned with a definition of the word can, and they say that can, or could in this case, should be defined as follows. A sentence of the form of S could have done X means if S had chosen to do X, S would have done X. So if we apply this to a real sentence, it would be if Smith had chosen to save the drowning child, he would have done so. For the sentence, Smith could have saved the drowning child. Now the conjunction of determinism and Smith did not save the drowning child does not entail the falsity of the sentence if Smith had chosen to save the drowning child, he would have done so. So in other words, it is compatible with determinism. It is compatible with determinism. Yeah, right, because he did not choose to save the drowning child, Like we isolate the willingness, or in this case unwillingness, of the agent to be a constituent of the state of the world that we use to compute our deterministic next state of the world, I guess. So that's how these two are compatible. But that's also the Achilles heel of this entire argument, because, well, I'll get to that later. Van Inwagen, first of all, says that if you apply this new analysis of the word can, then the argument would still be valid, because no matter how can is defined, J can neither modify P0 nor the laws of physics. So it doesn't really matter, because in the end, to change anything about the situation that he's in, he will still have to go against a state of the world before his birth or the laws of physics, which are bad odds for a mere human being. And also, should any premise turn out to be false, then Van Inwagen claims that the original premise is still valid. So he's just like, yeah, you can come and mess with my premises, but if they turn out to be false, then you're just wrong. I gave ample of proof for all of my premises, and if you mess around with my terminology, that's why I defined it so clearly. So the conditionalists run into a dilemma where they either do not put a dent in the argument at all, or they simply prove the conditional analysis wrong. And I think that's just a flaw of the conditional analysis anyway. So we're almost done. We've been talking a lot about Van Inwagen, so I'll just give you a quick rundown of what he's all about. He was born on September 21st, 1942. He is an analytic philosopher. He's the leading philosopher in contemporary metaphysics, philosophy of religion, and the philosophy of action. He used to be the president of the Society for Christian Philosophers from 2010 to 2013, and he's now a professor at the University of Notre Dame. Also, in an interview I watched with him, the interviewer led with something like, "So Peter, you're known to be the philosopher who reduced the wisdom of God," and that's what really just hooked me on Peter Van Inwagen being this badass philosopher who really kicks ass. And, well, it's kind of shitty to read, but I don't know. He has this really judging and crystal clear and brutal vibe, and I really dig that. So this leads us to our questions. From this point on, I will have to talk for another hour to guide everybody through questions, and I'm already dying. So thank you for your attention. I hope it was fun. And I need sleep.